organs and thromboembolic disease during pregnancy. Overview of the physiological changes of coagulation system in pregnancy. There is what is called a varicose stride, which is composed of hypercoagulability, venous stasis, and vascular damage. This is normal physiological changes occur during pregnancy. There is increase in the factors and also increase in antithrombin 3 and protein C, and decrease in protein S and increase in plasminogen activator inhibitor and platelet. Thrombocytopenia. Definition: platelet count less than 150. And there are two types commonly encountered during pregnancy: gestational thrombocytopenia and autoimmune thrombocytopenia. Gestational thrombocytopenia found in 7 to 8% of pregnancy. And there is mild fall of platelet count between 100 to 150, rarely associated with bleeding and poor maternal outcome, diagnosed by exclusion of other causes. Usually occurs in late pregnancy with no prior history outside pregnancy. No intervention is required other than platelet count monitoring during pregnancy. No risk of fetal thrombocytopenia. This is about the gestational thrombocytopenia. It is occur in one in each 5,000 pregnancy, ITP, caused by autoantibodies produced against platelet surface antigen, and it occur in at any gestational age of pregnancy. And there is 5 to 10% risk of fetal thrombocytopenia. Management includes serial monitoring of platelet level. Treatment considered if counts fall below 50 and nearby 10 by corticosteroid and IV immunoglobulin. Inherited coagulation disorders: von Willebrand disease, hemophilia A and B, carriers, factor 11 deficiency. All these account for 90% of all women with inherited bleeding disorders. Von Willebrand disease is the most common inherited bleeding disorder. Its prevalence is 1%. It is inherited as an autosomal dominant. Pre-pregnancy and antenatal management of patients with inherited hemophilia. Management should take place by a team in association with hemophilia center. Counseling prior to pregnancy. Baseline coagulation factors assessed as soon as pregnancy is confirmed and repeated in the third trimester. Fetal sex should be determined either by ultrasound or through sampling of fetal DNA in the maternal blood. This is because hemophilia is an X-linked disease. Invasive procedures should be covered with a clotting factor. Those with low factor level should receive prophylaxis to cover labor and delivery. If normal levels are attained during labor, no risk of hemorrhage during pregnancy or delivery. Management during labor and postpartum period. A clotting factor activity greater than 40 international units is safe for vaginal delivery. While in cesarean section, the level must be greater than 50 international units. As you see, in the vaginal, activity greater than 40, in the cesarean, greater than 50. Active management of third stage of labor to prevent bleeding. Cesarean section for obstetrical complications only. Cord blood should be sent for factor 8 level. Vitamin K can be given orally for the fetus and avoid IM injection. Tranexamic acid or recombinant factor replacement may need to be continued for several days postpartum. About an important subject. Disseminated intravascular coagulation, DIC, is almost always seen as a complication of an identifiable underlying pathological process against which treatment must be directed to reverse the defibrillation. Thus to say, DIC is a secondary and not a primary phenomenon. Clinical presentation. Excessive bleeding at site of trauma characterized by defective hemostasis. Persistent bleeding from venipuncture site, trauma from insertion of the catheter, and spontaneous bleeding from the gums or nose are signs of possible coagulation defect. Purpuric areas at pressure sites such as blood pressure cuffs clinically significant of thrombocytopenia. During surgery, continuous generalized oozing from the skin, subcutaneous and facial tissues. The retroperitoneal space or episiotomy site should at least suggest of coagulopathy. Here, as you see, coagulation, how it is occur, and fibrinolysis. What are the laboratory findings and treatment of DIC? Laboratory findings: low serum fibrinogen, decreased platelet count, increased fibrinogen degradation product, prolongation of PT and PTT. Treatment: call for help and ABC. Resolving the underlying cause and may require termination of pregnancy. Fresh frozen plasma, fresh blood or whole blood, cryoprecipitate. Thromboembolic disease during pregnancy. They are the most common cause of direct maternal death in UK. Physiological changes of pregnancy predispose a woman to thromboembolism, and this is further exacerbated by venous stasis in the lower limbs. Pregnancy is associated with 6 to 10 folds increase in the risk of venous thromboembolism compared to a non-pregnant woman. Without thromboprophylaxis, the risk of non-fatal pulmonary embolism and DVT is about 0.1. After delivery, the risk is increased to 1 to 2% and more after cesarean section. The venous thrombosis alone was more common antepartum, where pulmonary embolism was more common in the first 6 weeks postpartum. Yes. several important regulatory proteins act as an inhibitor in the coagulation cascade. Inherited or acquired deficiencies of these inhibitory proteins are collectively referred to as thrombophilias. Hereditary. Factor 5 Leiden, prothrombin, hyperhomocysteinemia, antithrombin deficiency, protein S deficiency, and protein C deficiency. While acquired, antiphospholipid antibodies and these autoantibodies are detected in about 2% of patients who have non-traumatic venous thromboembolism. The antibodies are directed against cardiolipins or against phospholipid binding proteins. Women with moderate to severe levels of these antibodies may have antiphospholipid syndrome. Antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. It is a complication of lupus anticoagulant with or without anticardiolipin antibodies. It may associate it, but commonly not, with other autoimmune disease such as SLE. Diagnosis by clinically and history and laboratory diagnosis. Clinically, history by fetal death of more than 10 weeks. Preterm birth less than 35 weeks due to severe preeclampsia or IUGR. Three or more unexplained miscarriages. Non-pregnant related history of venous or arterial thrombosis. While in laboratory diagnosis, anticardiolipin antibody IgG and or IgM medium to high titer in two occasions 8 weeks apart, or lupus anticoagulant also in two occasions 8 weeks apart. This is very important, very important. Thrombophilia. There are no randomized trials to guide prophylaxis to prevent recurrent adverse pregnancy outcome in women with any of the inherited thrombophilias. Some recommend consideration for empirical aspirin and or low molecular weight heparin. In general, treatment during subsequent pregnancies considered of enoxaparin 40 mg daily in those with previous pregnancy complications and 60 mg daily in those with a prior thromboembolic event. Thrombophilia and pregnancy complications. Early pregnancy loss, recurrent miscarriage, stillbirth, preeclampsia, placental abruption, IUGR. Venous thrombosis. Most cases of venous thrombosis during pregnancy are probably confined to the deep venous of the lower extremities, commonly occur in the left leg. Diagnosis. Clinical features, signs and symptoms include calf pain, which is the most common, redness and swelling, calf tenderness. Symptoms of underlying disease predisposing to DVT as preeclampsia. Unilateral symptoms should ring alarm bells. Investigations. Compression ultrasound. First line method with high sensitivity and specificity in the diagnosis of proximal DVT. Invasive contrast venography exclude lower limb extremity DVT, but not preferable in pregnancy due to radiation exposure. Impedance plethysmography. Extremely accurate test to assess thrombosis in the lower iliac, femoral, and popliteal veins has low sensitivity, and it is limited in use during pregnancy. Computed tomography. Widely available and very useful for detecting lower extremity deep venous thrombosis, as well as those with a vena cava and iliac and pelvic venous system. Magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, useful for diagnosis of iliofemoral and pelvic vein thrombosis, has high sensitivity and specificity. DVT during pregnancy and perpetuum. Any clinical suspicion of venous thromboembolism should be investigated as soon as possible. Graduated compression stocking should be worn in acute period. Before commencing treatment, blood should be taken for fasting blood and full blood count, renal and liver function test, clotting screen, and thrombophilia inheritance and acquired screen. While awaiting investigations, appropriate thromboprophylaxis should be commenced by using subcutaneous low molecular weight heparin, which is treatment of choice. This is very important. That's to say, while we are waiting until the investigation appears, not just waiting, but we must initiate treatment. This is very important. You must not lose time. During pregnancy and perpetuum, management of women should be in an obstetrical medicine or joint hematology and obstetrical clinic. Medical treatment. Unfractionated heparin treatment is with an intravenous heparin. Low molecular weight heparin, which is derivative of unfractionated heparin, has low molecular weight and it is a drug of choice, and it is given subcutaneously in two divided doses. Therapeutic anticoagulation should be continued throughout pregnancy and for at least 6 to 12 weeks after delivery or 6 months after the initial episode, whichever is the longer. Warfarin inhibits the synthesis of vitamin K-dependent factors, but rarely recommended during pregnancy due to the risk of teratogenicity, and should be avoided, stopped prior 6 weeks before pregnancy, and fetal intracerebral hemorrhage because it crossed the placenta, but it is used exceptionally in women with mechanical heart valve. Heparin. Low molecular weight heparin, both of them, does not cross the placenta. Safe and effective, also effective. Easy to administer and can be administered by the patient who require healthcare provider. Less hemorrhage, more hemorrhage. Less complication, more complication, less risk of thrombocytopenia, and less risk of osteoporosis. All here is the more. Here is less and here is more. Post-delivery management. Either conversion to warfarin or remain on low molecular weight heparin. Both are safe during breastfeeding. Gradual elastic stocking should be used initially in DVT and worn for 2 years following DVT. mobilization and avoidance of dehydration. Some consideration during the time of labor and delivery with the use of anticoagulants. Heparin treatment should be discontinued 24 hours prior to induction of labor or delivery by cesarean section. If spontaneous labor starts, no further heparin injected unless she has been assessed. To minimize the risk of epidural hematoma, regional techniques should be avoided 12 hours following prophylactic dose of low molecular weight heparin and 24 hours after therapeutic heparin. That's to say, we can't do epidural injection until 12 hours from the prophylaxis dose and 24 hours from the therapeutic dose. Rotamine sulfate can be used to reverse the effect of heparin. Summary of antenatal thromboprophylaxis. Women with a previous unprovoked venous thromboembolism or estrogen-related, including pregnancy or previous recurrent or other additional risk factors for venous thromboembolism, should be offered antenatal thromboprophylaxis with low molecular weight heparin. Women considered to be at a high risk of venous thromboembolism because of multiple risk factors, three or more, should be considered also thromboprophylaxis heparin. Here, as we say, in the antenatal period, we assess the history of the woman. She had previously venous thromboembolism or related to estrogen as a carcinogenic pregnancy, or when she was taking oral contraceptive pills, or she had recurrent venous thromboembolism. She must take thromboprophylaxis with low molecular weight heparin. All women with multiple risk factors, as three or more from the above, also she must take thromboprophylaxis. Woman, if she had inherited thrombophilia but no previous history of venous thromboembolism, do not require pharmacological thromboprophylaxis antenatally. Exception include what? If patient with multiple thromboembolic defect, including homozygous for factor V or antithrombin deficiency, or heritable thrombophilia with a strong family history of venous thromboembolism, especially pregnancy related. That's to say, when you take history from the mother and she had inherited the thrombophilia but she had never any previous history of venous thromboembolism, there is no require for thromboprophylaxis. Exception, if she had multiple thrombophilias and family history of hereditable thrombophilia and previous history of venous thromboembolism, especially if the history related to pregnancy, also you must offer her what? Prophylaxis, low molecular weight heparin. High and intermediate risk group antenatal prophylaxis heparin plus what? Hydration mobilization. Low risk group only hydration and mobilization. And in the postpartum period also high and intermediate risk group at least 6 weeks of low molecular weight heparin, hydration and mobilization. While also low risk group just hydration and mobilization. The same, that's to say, antenatal and postpartum period, both of high and intermediate, they must take low molecular weight heparin and hydration and mobilization, while low risk group in both just hydration and mobilization. Now we will talk about pulmonary embolism. It occurs with or without preceding DVT. Symptoms may range from mild disturbance to a sudden collapse and death, depending on the size, site, and number of emboli. Diagnosis. Clinically, dyspnea, chest pain, cough, hemoptysis, pyrexia, tachycardia, cyanosis, and raised JVP, and a massive pulmonary embolism, sudden cardiorespiratory collapse. Investigations. Initially, arterial blood gas analysis, ECG, chest x-ray, lower extremity, ultrasound to exclude DVT. These investigations are insufficient to exclude the diagnosis. So we must do ventilation perfusion scan if there is high suspicion of pulmonary embolism. CT pulmonary angiogram, which is the gold standard for diagnosis of pulmonary embolism. D-dimer commonly used as a screening test in non-pregnant women, but it is a clinical usefulness in limited in pregnancy. Why? Because the D-dimer normally it is increased during pregnancy. Risk factors for venous thromboembolism in pregnancy. Previous venous thromboembolism. Immobility if combined with body mass index more than 25. Body mass index more than 30. Smoking. Weight gain more than 21 kg during pregnancy. Parity more than 1, age more than 35, pre-eclampsia. GR, assisted reproductive technologies, twins, antepartum hemorrhage, postpartum hemorrhage, cesarean section. Medical conditions such as sickle cell disease, SLE, heart disease, anemia, infection, varicose veins, blood transfusion. Treatment of pulmonary embolism. Call for help plus ABC plus a multidisciplinary team management to decide about the treatment strategy. Intravenous unfractionated heparin is the preferred if massive pulmonary embolism with cardiovascular compromise. For the smaller, minimally symptomatic clots, low molecular weight heparin may be used. Warfarin is not suitable for pregnant women with acute stage, but suitable in postpartum period. Thrombolysis by streptokinase, most commonly used, is refers for hemodynamically unstable patient. It has side effect of major bleeding. Surgical embolectomy.